the recap of Batman, the animated series. I gave you guys 2 episodes, so yeah, not as many as before, but yeah, it was pretty Poison, which we first see Poison Ivy in, like, I think like one of her first media appearances. And it's cool to see her because, like, I don't know, besides the Uma Thurman version, I can't think of any other Poison Ivies than the Batman the Animated Series one.
I do feel that even, like, the Uma Thurman one, I feel like whatever was going on in Batman and Robin, I think they were, like, they got, like, a lot of really cool stuff from, like, the Batman the Animated TV mm-hmm. show. Like, they got, like, the Heart of Ice backstory.
Right, they just copied and pasted.
Like, yeah. They copied and pasted certain things, and then they were just, like, oh, well, Poison Ivy's sexy. That's like her thing. Mm-hmm. And didn't understand the rest of her. Yeah. Like, they watched like one episode of Poison Ivy and was just like, she's a femme fatale. That's what it is. Just to get Uma Thurman and just like have her like try to get dudes. Like, that's what mm-hmm. it is.
Yeah, she's very seductive in that movie. Yeah, she plays that character well.
Yeah, and she's kind of seductive in this because she very much is like trying to play that femme fatale, like the what was it, the like in a noir movie, the mm-hmm. like the woman in like red lipstick, you know.
Yeah,
you know she's dangerous, and you're gonna fall for her.
That's why you have rubber lips.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, exactly. That's why you have rubber lips like Robin.
Oh yeah,
that's so dumb. That's so dumb, Batman and Robin. Like, God, that's like,
damn it, that's yeah. the smartest thing I've ever fucking heard. Rubber lips.
It's like shark repellent.
Yeah, that's how that works. That is definitely how that works.
Yeah. I was gonna say, do you guys like ship Harvey and Two-Face and Poison Ivy? Because that's like an interesting couple right there.
I have to say it's you know, it has been a minute for me since I've actually watched the animated series. So when I went back to kind of prep for this, I forget how in so many other iterations, whether it be like the movies or other animated shows, when they present these characters, they're kind of like, there's Poison Ivy. But in this one, it's like, here's Pamela. This is what she's about. Here's Harvey. Yeah. Here's what he's about. And it's, contrary to the medium, it doesn't feel cartoonish. So they do seem like real people, and the dialogue works really well. And I really enjoyed how they were able to interact. And, you know, honestly, I think if she wasn't kind of crazy, they might have been able to work it out. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, what would their kids have been like?
maybe if she was in his corner, he might have not have gone off the edge himself.
Right. Or I don't know. Maybe Harvey should have been like, he should have like been more like to her causes, like environmentalism or something.
He'd been like, yeah, let's do it. And then she would have been like, oh.
You're right, Gene. Harvey's at fault in this one. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Harvey's at fault.
Yeah.
How dare Harvey?
I was gonna say it's Harvey. Right, yeah. It's interesting how they really make Harvey a character in this show, because we mm-hmm. see him like just as a normal guy before he goes full on Two-Face. Like, I think Two-Face has one of the best arcs in Batman the Animated Series.
Yeah, I mean, this isn't the first time that Two-Face really gets like an arc in a Batman TV mm-hmm. show. I believe that for WB, there used to be the Batman.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
And like he has a huge like portion of he has Harvey Dent. What was it? They also did Clayface
I think Clayface was basically their Two-Face, because they had Batman's friend Ethan Bennett.
I don't know if they had Two-Face on
it. It was Clayface.
Yeah, right. They made Clayface Harvey Dent. Yeah.
They essentially just switched it, and they were just like, he's Clayface now.
Yeah,
and everything like that. But I do actually like seeing people who have known Bruce forever mm-hmm. and them also kind of going like, you know, just like, hey, you know, it's impossible for him to be Batman. Like, I've known Bruce for years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. They really buy into the like the fake-aid of the mask of Bruce Wayne.
Yeah. Like, even when they see Bruce Wayne, they're not Bruce Wayne in a bat suit, they're not just like, Bruce?
Yeah. I think, you know what I thought? I think you're thinking of Beware the Batman for the Two-Face arc.
Yes.
The CGI one. Okay. Did you guys ever see did you see that?
Yeah.
That
was actually not bad. It came and it went like 8 years ago. Yeah. They were like, this isn't giving us toys, the money for toys. It's not giving them the right ratings.
Alfred has
a secret agent. He has guns. It has katana.
Yeah, Katana's a sidekick. Yeah.
Yeah, Katana's a sidekick. It's like that, Fish Robin.
That show, I thought it was actually pretty good, but it really, like, I believe, like, the last five episodes, they literally dropped on Toonami or Adult Swim or something at, like, 3 a.m., and they're like, all right, the show's over. Like,
I could appreciate their attempt to use kind of these Batman villains you don't see. I mean, I think there was, like, Professor Pig. There was, what's the name of the bird-themed thief?
The Flamingo. I think it's El Flamingo.
He was on Batwoman. I remember. I forget her name.
I think he was on Batwoman. And also, I think he was on the Batman, like the old Adam West Batman.
Too. Oh, really?
Yeah.
Has like Egghead in it.
Yeah. There's a bunch of different Bat villains.
Yeah. That was a good show. It's on HBO Max. I'm not sure if anyone could check that out. But
The Magpie.
Magpie. Yeah.
That's right. I had to type it up.
Well, it's all right. These are like really obscure villains. So, like,
I can appreciate that.
You know, well, no judgment in like not getting these names right. Cause it's like, this is like a character that's appeared in like two issues. It's like no one's going to remember their name.
I think they also had like Mr. Toad. I remember seeing that for the first time and I was like, Mr. Toad.
It's all the Grant Morrison villains.
Yeah. I'm like, what the hell? I don't remember Mr. Toad. Like, when was the last time I saw Mr. Toad? What the hell? Like that's a pull. But
good show though.
Poison Ivy, I really dig what they were trying to do with her in this one. Like they really did cement like this is her backstory. This is what she's like kind of going for. She is an environmentalist and she's not entirely crazy, but she's kind of nuts.
Yeah, like, she's just she's very like goal focused.
Yeah,
there you go. Yeah,
I can respect a career woman.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, that's it.
And you know, just since the Batman was mentioned earlier, I remember the Poison Ivy there was just that depiction there. She was like a young teen environmentalist.
Oh yeah, she's Batgirl's friend, right?
Yeah, Batgirl's friend, and I believe she got caught up in like a sewage spill or something. And just comparing those depictions, this one just feels so human. You know what I mean? It's very authentic in how it's written, and it's not like, oh, she's just a silly environmentalist. There's depth to the character is surprisingly achieved in this one episode. So I appreciated it.
Oh, for sure. Because I was going to say, the actress is Diane Pershing.
Yes.
She's often associated with the character. I think in some of the Batman animated series, like games or other media, she always comes back. And she's really great. I think like she's up there with like, you know, Conroy and Mark Hamill in terms of like these like definitive portrayals of the character. So I have to commend her for her work on that character. Cause I think of like, you know, I think of her voice as opposed to like Uma Thurman or someone when I think of Poison Ivy.
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, I always think of Uma Thurman.
You always think of Uma Thurman. Well, just because the puns. I wonder what Uma Thurman like thinks of that, because like what like George Clooney was like, he's always apologizing for that movie. I think like Arnold.
I feel like she doesn't care.
She doesn't care.
I feel like she doesn't care for one, because it's not the worst movie Uma Thurman's been in.
No. Like the Avengers. The Avengers. I don't know. It's not the Marvel Avengers, but it's like the BBC remake.
The British Avengers.
I heard that movie is like just, I've never seen it, but I've heard it's just like awful. Like it's
my
just
brother loves that movie.
Justin would love that movie.
Well, he's movie. Wrong.
He's wrong. Probably.
No, I'm just kidding. I've never seen it. I don't know. No,
yeah, because I mean, it just has it has Sean Connery as the villain. That's why he likes it.
Sean Connery, Eddie Izzard is also a villain. Who else is in it? But I mean, it's not a bad movie. I've watched it. I used to watch it when I was a kid.
Yeah, I mean, we used to watch Batman and Robin when I was a kid, and I thought it was good too.
It's still good.
It's still good. Yeah. All right, but I guess we kind of see the emergence of Big Bad Harv in this episode. Mm-hmm. Kind of some like hints at that. It's like, because it's interesting. Before he's Two-Face, it's shown that he has like a dual personality already. So it just kind of like adds to these like problems in his mental health. And like in the comics and stuff, I believe, I don't know if they've updated it with like all the different continuities or like different like reboots or like relaunches, but usually like Harvey is gets all his like kind of like trauma, like, I think from his dad, right? His dad like abuses him. I think they talk about that in Long Halloween.
I don't remember.
Yeah, because it's like he has the coin because I think his dad used to do that. Yeah. It's an, I need to reread Long Halloween because they're coming out with the animated movie. But he gets a lot of trauma, I think, from that. And he has like sort of this, you know, he has like already signs of like his break even before the scarring. So
but it usually only happens in like stressful moments.
Right.
And stuff like that. Yeah. Like it's like when something like really needs to get done, or if he's like a gun's getting pointed in his face or anything like that. That's when Big Bad Harv kind of starts like appearing.
Yeah. Like, yeah. In the animated show, yeah, we'll see in the next couple episodes, right?
Which is very sad, because, you know, maybe if you have a mental health issues, you shouldn't exacerbate it by being like a district attorney, but that's what he wants, so, you know.
It's... Right. Yeah, he's a very tragic character. Two-Face doesn't get enough love sometimes. It's always people overlooking for a Joker or something, you know?
Yeah. Also, if you also have a personality in your head, that's called Big Bad Harv. Seek help.
Seek help.
I mean, if everyone went to therapy, the world would be a lot better place. You know,
probably.
Yeah. But any other thoughts to add to this episode? Like, I thought it was one of the better animated series episodes. So,
It is a really good episode. It has like a solid plot to it and everything like that. It's a great introduction of Poison Ivy, more or less good introduction of Harvey Dent. Because you understand who Harvey Dent is, even if you don't know he's Two-Face, which I think is kind of better if you don't know he's Two-Face.
Oh, definitely.
It makes you care. It really does make you care about Harvey and Bruce and Harvey's relationship.
Right.
And you're really hoping he saves him.
Yeah.
When in the future, if you let him die, then, you know, it's one less villain.
Yeah, I mean, it's like kind of, I could see maybe The Dark Knight was inspired by, well, some of these episodes. I think they were, because it's like there's references, because there's Roland Daggett in the animated series, and I forgot what his name is in The Dark Knight Rises. Like, he has a different first name, but there's Daggett, played by Ben Mendelsohn. So they did watch the animated series, I'm sure. So, yeah, I could definitely see the influence in The Nolan's just had
Batman the Animated Series in the background.
Nolan's not like the biggest comic fan, but he did the work. Like, he read like all the essential novels. I'm sure he watched like the TV series, the cartoons. Like, he did more work than Tim Burton, who like famously said, "I only read like two comics."
That makes sense.
I like the Burton Batmans, but like, it does show he's not as familiar with the lore of the character. Plus Tim Burton, but you know. It's true. So I guess we'll go to the next episode, Nothing to Fear. We have Scarecrow.
Speaking of therapists.
Oh, I know, right? Yeah.
And people who need them.
Yeah.
Scarecrow. Have you met him?
but this is this is an interesting episode, because I think like Scarecrow gets like a lot of, almost like they really relaunch him several times. Like, of all the characters that they kind of like use, Scarecrow gets revamped the most, because they're there's the sequel show, The New Batman Adventures, and like for this he's kind of like a scarecrow. He literally looks like a scarecrow, and then like in The New Batman Adventures he literally looks like a zombie. Yeah. They make him I love that costume.
There's three different designs for the scarecrow. One is that he has a very like penciled neck, where it's like very sharp, and then what was it? And it looks like a sack over his head. The other one is he has like the hat with the mask and everything like that. And it looks a lot more kind of like the horseman kind of vibe to it.
Uh-huh.
And then that last one is more of like that kind of like the zombie caretaker that killed himself, because he also has like the noose around his neck. Mm-hmm. And stuff like that. I actually really like the new Batman Adventures design. Mm-hmm. That by far is one of the cooler ones.
While watching that, I kind of realized that I think the current costume of Scarecrow in the comics kind of takes inspiration from the new Batman Adventure look.
Yeah, I think so. I think even like Arkham Knight uses that design, because that's one of my favorite costumes for Scarecrow is the Arkham Knight one, and then you have like he's voiced by Jonathan Nobel. So yeah, that's really great. But yeah, it's interesting like how they use Scarecrow. I mean, this is kind of like, it's a really quick episode, but this also has like the first time, you know, Batman says his iconic line, like Kevin Conroy, it's like, I am vengeance, I am the knight, I am Batman.
I am Batman.
And that's really cool because they use that all the time for like promos. Like they used it for Cartoon Network, for like Boomerang, like every single, like that is like one of the coolest lines ever. And he, you know, I'm not sure if you guys heard the story, because it famously has like been told by Kevin Conroy.
Ooh, tell me.
Okay, so Kevin Conroy, because I believe he lived in New York in the 2000s for a while. Yeah, he was like he was one of the relief workers after 9/11 fell. So he was like helping like in the soup kitchen, things like that. And he said, I guess someone recognized his voice. And they asked him, like, are you Batman? He said, yeah. And then, like, can you, like, do one of the lines? So he said, like, and this is just, like, off the cuff. Like, he just said it really loud. And he said, like, I am vengeance, I am the night. And, like, everyone, like, heard that. And, like, it's, like, all the firefighters, other, like, victims, what have you. And they all, like, as soon as they heard that, everyone just started clapping. And, like, I think, he was just saying, like, I guess, like, that was the, you know, kind of first, like cheers or applause he heard during some of those.
I love Kevin Conroy.
Yeah, Kevin Conroy's great. We got to interview him a couple years back now. And he's just
I'm going to have to dig that up.
Oh, yeah, no, I'll send it to you.
Yeah, Kevin Conroy is a peach.
Love him.
Yeah, he's a cool guy. He's a very cool guy. Very easy to talk to, everything like that.
Very tall. he's like 6'5".
Yeah, that man's a giant. he can whoop somebody. He can be bad.
Yeah, probably.
He can definitely.
I'm into that. I'm down for it.
Yeah. But yeah, we stand Kevin Conroy. But just,
I really do like the idea of this episode, because this episode is, yeah, you have a Scarecrow trying to burn down a university.
Mm-hmm.
It's essentially what it is. But the real meat and potatoes of this episode is, because if you go into like the first episode of Batman, you don't really get his origin. You don't really get like the death of his parents. You don't get, you know, the tragic of Joe Chill and everything like that. Like, you don't really get any of that. They waited all the way until episode 8 to really drop this stuff on you.
It's not like
just like, oh yeah, like we're doing like dark shots or anything like that. No, they're like honing in on Batman's parents' death, and they're making Batman live in the moment. And it's so interesting. It's just such an interesting idea.
Yeah.
And it's so cool that that's like his fear.
Yeah, like disappointing like Thomas Wayne or his parents. Mm. Yeah, because that, you know, if you think about it, his whole life is basically shaped by his parents. You know, if they weren't killed, like he wouldn't be Batman.
Well, not only that, but also it's really interesting too, because there are future episodes where Scarecrow is there and Batman gets dosed with fear toxin, and it's very interesting to kind of see where Batman's like life is kind of going or proceeding, because right now it's I have a mission, I have to make sure that my parents are proud of what I'm doing. Then later on it's more of like protection of like, you know, Batgirl and everybody else.
Yeah, like that's the that's that one episode where it's all a nightmare for
over the edge.
Yeah,
I believe that's Batgirl who gets dosed, I think. But I know what you mean, like the evolution of his own psyche and his own focus of his mission, which is really well done.
That's a good point because
there's a lot of really good setup, because you can actually see character growth throughout the times that he actually gets like kind of dosed, because you don't really get a lot of inner monologues with Kevin Conroy's Batman.
No, you know, it's not like Dark Knight Returns.
Yeah, it's not like Dark Knight Returns. But I mean, that was like a huge thing in, you know, the Batman or like comic books when he was by himself, was he would have a lot of internal monologues, and you kind of know what Batman's thinking.
Yeah.
And it's interesting to kind of actually get an episode of seeing what exactly is Batman afraid of. Like, this guy is supposed to be scary. What scares the nightmare?
Yeah.
Like, you know?
Yeah.
And this is a great episode to show that.
Oh, no. I think so as well. Because, yeah, it's just, I think it's a pretty, yeah, just revealing episode of this version of Batman. And also, he kind of ages throughout these two series because he's like, shows maybe he's like 30, 28. And mm-hmm. then with the first Robin, then the second Robin, you know, he's getting older. And then, you know, Batman Beyond, he's like an old guy. He's an old man, you know? It's like yeah. one of the coolest.
I've always wanted to know why they skipped Jason Todd.
He's in the comics right now.
In
the comic, they kind of introduced him as like a quick temporary Robin who
he was like
reckless.
The animated series?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's in continuity because it's by Bruce Timm and Paul Dini. The story, they didn't write the script, but they did do the story. So if it's by them, it's in continuity.
Yeah. Red Hood shows up.
Yeah.
So all our comic fans out there, if you want to find out about Red Hood in the DCAU, I guess.
Yeah, definitely check that out because we've recommended it before in the show.
So what you're telling me is that Jason Todd could meet Terry McGinnis.
Good. Potentially, yeah.
That's pretty cool.
But yeah, I guess that wraps up our Batman the Animated Series recap, and we'll move on to the next topic.